Welcome, everyone, to our kickoff conversation today. Coming off a terrific new paper called Out of the Box, we have two of the three authors. For those joining us, just so you know, I'm Michael Horn, author of the new book, From Reopen to Reinvent. Delighted to have Joel Rose, the founder of Teach to One, and Janae Henry Wood, the head of learning at Transcend, to talk about a paper that I think is truly out of the box that will really set the tone for the conversation that we want to have today, but that the country needs to have around modernizing our education for all our students. And as we get in this conversation, I just want to lay the foundation. And Janae, I'd love to start with you, which is, before we get into the really important solutions that this paper Out of the Box starts to detail and suggest that we need to move toward, lay out for us, what is the problem in your mind with the current education system that we have?
Thanks, Michael. It's a great question. And so because I know we're not here all evening, I'll try to sort of lay out from our perspective how we're thinking about this challenge. So, I have been in education now for almost 15 years, and I know there are many people who have been in much longer, 30, 50, 60 years. And in that time, we have tried to make and have made a lot of advancements with how we educate our young people. We have tried to think of a lot of different inputs. We have thought about, do they have textbooks? Does everybody have a computer? What is the quality of the teacher in the classroom? What are the standards that we're working towards? And all of those things matter. They are all necessary and deeply important. What we've come to between our two organizations and many other people that we've been in conversation with is that that question actually is shadowing the other critical question, which is, what is the paradigm that we are currently operating under? What is the design of the system that we are currently operating under? And is that thing servicing us? So we've basically said to ourselves, we think that our current model is what we call, as many people would call, there are many names for this, but we call it the industrial paradigm. And the industrial paradigm emerged as a massively important thing, right? It helped get access to education for lots of people, basic reading, basic writing. So we don't want to completely say, oh, forget this thing, this wasn't helpful. But the industrial paradigm has some inherent limitations. And what we are finding is that the latest of our efforts, the last, let's call it 30 to 40 years, what we've been doing, I think, Michael and Joel, I think you would agree, is we've been trying to optimize on that industrial model. We've been trying to squeeze all the juice that we could possibly squeeze out of it. How do we get better classes? How do we get higher standards? How can we train and support teachers? And again, all of that is massively critical and massively important. But one of the things that we see is that this model, this industrial paradigm, has in it some intangible fixed qualities that make it really, really hard to see the kinds of results that we want for young people. When we think about the jobs for the 21st century, jobs that are happening right now, the skills that we are seeing that young people need, we particularly saw this during the shutdowns and the pandemic. When we think about collaboration, when we think about self-drivenness, when we think about the need to be able to drive one's own learning, the industrial paradigm actually squeezes out the potential for that way of being. And so students get one kind of experience in the industrial model, one that is guided by a teacher at the head of the classroom, usually working their way through a textbook in same base age cohorts. And we're just learning and seeing evidence all over the place that we have likely optimized the best that we can do with this industrial paradigm. And we've really got to move to what we are calling a student-centered paradigm, where those experiences are fundamentally different. So I think in summary, I would say the problem that we are facing right now is the difference between optimization and modernization. We in the education sector, with all of our partners, we have really been trying to optimize a current broken model. And what we really need to do is find the tools, work together, and think about how to modernize the education system for the new skills for the century ahead. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it does. And before I turn to you, Joel, I just want to stay on you for one beat, Janae, because I think in the paper itself, you have this very powerful graphic laying out exactly what that industrial paradigm is that I think roots those problems very clearly. So I was just wondering if you could share it and talk us through it briefly.
Yeah, great. Joel, if you have that, click that up, but I'll talk a bit about it, as best I can. So the industrial paradigm, we think that there are one way to think about school is to route ourselves to center the experiences that students are having. So when we often talk about school, we often say, Michael, well, what are they learning? What are the teachers doing? What does the building look like? Do we have the right tools, the right computers, things like that? But what we're not often asking is, what are the actual experiences that young people are having? How would we characterize those? So our hypothesis is that there are sort of 10 experiences that no matter where you go, I could walk into a classroom right now. I'm in New Haven, Connecticut. I could walk into a classroom in New Haven. I could walk into a classroom in New York or Atlanta, lots of different places. And I might see these 10 core experiences, even given that those schools are in very different contexts and places. And what we often see is a narrow focus in schools, meaning young folks, we are focusing primarily on the cognitive dimension of learning. We're not focusing in on the mental and the emotional dimensions. We usually see young folks engaging in, frankly, irrelevant learning. Sometimes they don't have the context or the schema for the learning. It's random, disconnected facts that aren't actually deeply embedded in the experience of the world that they see. We might see isolation. Young people working at their desk, doing work by themselves, teachers in classrooms working by themselves. Obviously, not every single school is doing this. There are some people that are really making significant leaps. But the industrial paradigm, by and large, has these 10 core experiences. And what we want to do is move to a world where we have a student-centered paradigm. And that student-centered paradigm has a set of experiences that we'll talk about, you know, a little bit later that I think is so critical. Those students and that student-centered paradigm is going to move us from a narrow focus where we're only thinking about the cognitive dimension of learning to a whole focus where we're thinking about the mental, the physical, the emotional. We want to move from a world where young folks are doing rote activities and memorization to a world where we've got far more rigorous learning, where young people are actually creating new knowledge, creating new ideas. We want to move from a place where some children feel isolated or forced to assimilate to a certain way of thinking or a certain way of being, to one where they're really feeling affirmed. And so we think that these experiences are possible through what we are calling innovative learning models. And we'll talk about it a little bit more. I know we'll dive in depth, but the central question here that, you know, you in the audience might be wondering is, well, how am I going to go from what the industrial paradigm to the student-centered paradigm? And I think that's the crux of what we're trying to tackle in the paper. How do we get from this left side to these right sides of experiences? And we think we have a hypothesis for how we do that.
So, Joel, I want to turn to you. You and I have been having this dialogue, I think, for 15 years or so almost at this point about, you know, that the model we have, if you will, really does what it was designed to do. You know, Janae talked about that ability to scale universal access, but that a lot of the failures we see are embedded in the design of the model itself. And I think what's more, you know, Janae's point that a lot of the things that we've done in the name of reform over the last few decades have really been layered over those fundamental assumptions. So, you know, what's holding us back from moving forward toward that direction, that student-centered direction that Janae started to lay out, Joel?
Great. Thanks, Michael. We have been talking about this for quite a while, but I think in that time we've really gotten much clearer about what those barriers are, what stands in the way of getting to the type of paradigm that Janae spoke about. And I think they really fall into three categories. The first category is demand. Most school communities, most school boards, most districts are going to continue to use and buy and purchase the things they're most familiar with. Because they are not necessarily looking for new ways of doing school, that leads to the second problem, is there's not a lot of supply. That even if you were a school community that said, we actually want to provide the kinds of experiences that Janae just talked about, what can I do to do that? There's not a lot out there. And that's because most of the providers, because they need to scale, are building things for the industrial paradigm. If you build something that is for the student-centered paradigm, that may be quite impactful. But if schools aren't ready for that, that's going to limit the supply. And then the third barrier are barriers around policy. So whether it's policies around, let's say, assessment and accountability that measure progress, that measure success only on the basis of grade level assessments, that makes it harder, for example, to personalize learning. But policies also around textbook procurement, around class size, around all the rules that kind of get into the optimization of the current industrial paradigm. There may be other ways of helping to provide students with a much richer education, but that don't necessarily comply with what those policies assume.
So I think it's a perfect kickoff, right, to start to dig into the solution side of this, because in the paper, you both introduce this notion of model providers as a solution out of these challenges and as a way to start to move out of the 10 principles, right, of the industrial-centered paradigm that you just laid out. Before we get into all that, and I want to race ahead because there's a bunch of implications on supply demand. There's a bunch of implications on funders and what they need to be doing and what kind of funding may be inappropriate for this sort of set of solutions. But I want to step back and say, like, a central part of what you're recommending is new models, and that these model providers, you call them, will create very different ways, if you will, of doing schooling that start to escape maybe not all 10, but some subsets of these principles. So just what is a model provider itself, and how is it different, say, from maybe a new school that people have created from scratch, or things that we've perhaps been familiar with over the course of ed reform over the last few decades? Joel, do you want to jump in first, and then Janae, you follow right back up?
Sure. Do you want to do it in that way, Joel?
Sounds fine. Let's talk first about what we mean by a model before we get to model providers. So a model is really a school-based program that bundles together an interconnected set of tools, systems, practices in order to deeply shape a student's learning experience. It would typically have an instructional design, a set of pedagogical practices, an operational design that gets into the actual workflow of the classroom, and a technological design. And all of those pieces are really centered on a coherent way of providing students with a high-quality instructional experience. Now, models can be both models to support the industrial paradigm or models that can support a student-centered paradigm. But one way or another, a model is a program, effectively, that a school can adopt and embrace for whichever paradigm they're looking to actualize. We would consider an innovative learning model a model that actually helps schools to move from the industrial paradigm to a student-centered paradigm. Now, the question is, well, where do these models come from? And what is true in our sector is, unlike sectors like energy and defense and healthcare, there is not an ecosystem of organizations that are designing the future. We have a little bit of money that goes into R, not a whole lot that goes into the D, and so that's one big reason why we do a lot of optimization in K-12. Model providers are organizations that have the capacity to design these experiences and then to support the implementation of those models within existing schools, but they are not the school operator. So models can be implemented in district schools, in charter schools, or in independent schools, but the teachers and the administrative staff stay on the payroll of the school operator. They aren't on the payroll of the model provider.
Janae, in your answer, just one quick thing, Janae, if in your answer, could you talk a little bit about what these model providers and models might look like that start to escape the paradigm? And I think a question that a lot of people tuning in are going to be curious about is, can a school create these models, or is it like have to be an outside entity?
Yeah, I think it's a great question. Joel, in picking up what you said, one of my favorite metaphors of all time is the way you've shared about how the airline industry thinks about this. So we don't have pilots in rooms sketching the airplane, designing the seat buckles, designing, you know, the wings, and then being like, all right, it's time to go fly this plane and get these people where they got to go. We don't do that, but we do that for teachers. And so I think it's a really helpful mental model that you've shared before, Joel, to help folks get their minds around what it can be. So the question, Michael, of like, what could these models actually look like? I think it's helpful to know that these models can be things like a subject-specific model. So imagine a school community were to say, we really need to think about a different way to move to do math. We can no longer sit here having our kids look at a smart board, which might be a leap in an innovation from a whiteboard, but it's still like a board nonetheless. We want them to be doing much more collaborative work. We want them to be able to go at their own pace, to decide and to be able to practice what they're great at, to practice places where, you know, they're not so great. And we need a new model for how to do that. So an innovative math model might be designed not around a textbook, but an innovative math model might use technology in a fundamentally different way to actually personalize and understand where is Janae relative to Joel when it comes to this thing we're trying to learn. Maybe Joel is like really, really great at complex fractions. I'm like really not there. That doesn't mean that Joel and I sitting in the same classroom need to be focusing in on the same thing all the time. So what if we were to bring in some technological components? By the way, we've made huge leaps and bounds in technology over the last couple of decades. What if we were to actually use that in the classroom? So the first experience could be I, as an individual young person, understand where I am in math. Now, let's push it further. What if that math model were to include independent work, but it were to also include some group work? So there were elements where I was working in small groups with other people, coming together with Joel, who might be much better at this skill than I am, doing some independent projects together. What if it were to include a segment where I was working with a teacher or a paraprofessional who was helping me do some remediation? There are lots of different, you know, ways that we can apply models. You can have a social studies model that is very oriented around current events and very literacy based, so they can be very subject specific. And what we find is that schools, I think a very small amount of schools, might be able to develop these models all on their own. I don't want to discount the fact that schools are innovation-laden places and that teachers and administrators know things from years of engaging young people. But what we've also found is that schools don't often have the space, the true space that it takes to take on a big question, Michael, like how do we reimagine the math experience? So some of these model providing organizations can have the space, the R&D, the funding, the significant capacity that it takes to do this. And school communities, we have found under certain conditions, absolutely can develop models themselves, but they need significant support from other organizations to do so. So does that begin to answer your question?
I think so. And I think it's a good bridge, frankly, into something that you talk extensively about in the paper. About the supply and demand of and for new models, new model providers. And that is, you know, the way you all break it down as supply is how do we make more of these? And Joel, I thought you did a good job of saying this is what we would consider an innovative model as opposed to, say, a model still stuck in the industrial paradigm. How do we start to create more of these and generate them as answers to these different leaps forward from sort of the 10 characteristics of the industrial paradigm to the student-centered world, and then demand you have is how schools, if you will start to ingest them and start to incorporate and ask for these new models. And so in the question, I think I want to start with the demand side, which is districts, you know, Joel, you pointed this out, they know how to purchase curriculum, right? Both digital and analog at this point. That wasn't necessarily true when we all got into this field many years ago. They know how to pay for PD. They know how to buy even like administrative systems like SISs and LMSs and things like that. But most of them are not demanding model providers in great numbers today. You all obviously both have worked with and represent some exceptions to this. But I want to dig into this demand side. Like, why is it that they're not demanding it? And then how do we change it and spark demand? So maybe, Janae, let's start with like the why are they not demanding? And then we can turn to the how do we change this?
Yeah, great question. So it's really hard, I think, Michael, to demand something that you haven't seen or that you're not aware of. That can be really hard, right? And we are, you know, in a system, for better or for worse, that in many ways rewards compliance, rewards like we do things how we've always done it. It's efficient. You know, we move millions of children from home to school every day. We get it done, right? So there's an element of it's habit and like we also don't know about it. It's also true that schools have really fixed budget lines. And so I haven't looked at a school budget in a minute, but I've never seen in a school budget research and development to bring in model providers, right? So there's also that missing element of it's really hard to also do something you can't fund. One thing I want to do is kind of is to expand our notion of demand. And this is something that I think we do a little bit of the paper, certainly something that we care about in our work. Districts are part of the demand. So are school communities themselves. You know, districts can create, I think, the conditions for school communities to take on and to innovate and to try new things. They obviously need to support it, but districts can really create the conditions for school communities themselves, because school communities themselves, even within one district, as we know, might need very different things. The other thing that we think matters here in this equation are the role of young people themselves and of parents. And so when we think about demand, I think we need to think about that whole total picture and think about the ways in which we engage that whole total picture with the innovations that we know. So there used to be a day and age where we would go into a, you know, a conference room, make a new math program or curriculum or book. The district would buy it. Maybe the parents would know about it. Maybe the young people would know about it. And then boom, all of a sudden it's adopted. Or we would say, we've got the answer for the kinds of schools that you need. It's one model, take it, boom, 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 copy paste across the country. I think what model providing its potential, and especially on the demand side, is that schools can be taking models and working with the model providers to adopt and adapt them a bit for their context. There might be some things that might not work in Atlanta, but might really work in New Haven. And those might be a small set of things, but it gives the opportunity for a community, for a school community, to do that work. So on the demand side, I think the barriers for why are, one, when supply is not abundant, it can be hard to demand something that you don't know about. Two, oftentimes the money is not there. So even if you have a leader that knows about it, that has seen Joel's work or has seen Transcend's work, is really excited, where are they going to get the funds and the permission to make that happen? And so those are two sort of big demand barriers. But I think, Joel, when you talk a bit about supply, I think there's a way to really bridge that so that folks know about it and know what to demand.
So, Joel, let's go there, right? Because I love where Janae just left us. And I will say, selfishly, from my perspective, you know, in my new book, I talk a lot about how you have to have the community come to that conversation around what's the purpose of schooling and what's their various flavor of it, so that you're innovating with, not to, a community. So I'm this point really resonates with me. But Joel, let's how do you start to change and spark that demand in your view, and connecting it to that question of supply specifically as well?
Yeah. So Janae is absolutely right. You know, if you're the head of math in Milwaukee, what are your real options if you want to move to a student-centered paradigm that you even know about? And so why do we have such a dearth of solutions that can actually help schools to do that? And I think one reason is actually just in the data. I'm going to show you two charts that show, on the left-hand side, this is the R&D investment by industry in 2019. You see how much of the total revenue in computing, electronics, and healthcare and auto goes to R&D, goes to creating new versions of the iPhone or new Hondas or whatever the case may be. And there's one sector, of course, that you don't see here at all, and that's education. It's buried in the other category. And most of what's there is, frankly, more research than it is development. Now, when there is this type of market failure, what we often see is the public sector side filling that gap. So there is some R&D, for example, in areas like healthcare and energy and defense. But when the risk is too high for the private sector to absorb, we have public sector investment in those areas. And you see how much we invest with public dollars in R&D, in defense, in human services, and energy. At dead last among all federal agencies at $346 million annually is the Department of Education. And that may seem like a lot of money, but know that, one, 80% of that is research, not development. But two, to put $346 million in context, in 2019, Snap alone, the makers of Snapchat, spent $1 billion on R&D. So that's kind of why so many of our kids are sort of focused more on Snap than they are in K-12, is we aren't doing the work to actually innovate, to create better ways of doing school. We're relegated to, you know, putting out papers and having conferences about what's possible, rather than actually doing the R&D work to make it a reality.
So this bleeds, I think, perfectly into the last couple questions that I have as we wrap up. And just to call it out, there are some terrific breakout sessions that you all have lined up for the rest of this day that will explore a lot of these strands much more in depth. So treat this from Joel and Janae as sort of like the hint of what's to come and the depth that is worth exploring. But I want to start on the policy and funding front. I think you just spoke, Joel, to the funding challenges. They're just not being a lot of funding that's going into the R&D, frankly, for these new model providers. I'll specifically say also, there's a reason venture capital is not going to be the answer to this, which is, and my one push a little bit on the paper is that I don't think it's the fragmentation per se of 14,000 plus school districts. It's the fact that those 14,000 plus school districts are all anchored in the industrial model. So the only way to get scale mm-hmm. is to fit their needs. Like there's plenty of fragmented marketplaces that scale, but it's when those entities or people are looking for innovative solutions. So what do we have to do from a funding perspective? And what can philanthropies, governments start to do to really get the right supply in there and start to change this? And then if you're going to go to the notion of an exchange, hold, because Janae, that'll be my last question. But Joel, maybe you first, and Janae, I want to hear you on this as well, just starting to shift the policy and funding landscapes.
Sure. We, with this paper, are really hoping to sort of stand up or try to give a big jolt to the model provider sector. And part of that means standing up multiple organizations that are developing new models in different subjects and in different grade spans. We hope the philanthropic community can sort of see the leverage and the wisdom in investing in model providers and can support the R&D that's required to bring these to life. There are also now some bills in Congress around funding R&D that include language around innovative learning models. Philanthropy can help, for sure. And now is a great time because many school districts actually have plenty of money to do the doing of school. And philanthropy may find a much more, there's more leverage in helping to develop model providers than there is to funding the system directly. But that won't be the longer term solution. The longer term solution needs to be, we need to invest in education R&D in the same way we invest in R&D for other sectors to really design the future and make it happen, not just to hope that one day by osmosis it will.
Great point, Joel. And I think one thing that we need in order to do that is that you're probably sitting, audience, like in your seats and you're wondering, so what does this look like? And the conversation we've been having has been, you know, pretty high level. But Transcend, the organization that I work with, has released an innovative models exchange where we are trying to hold and condense and codify and make meaning of the models that different model providers have created from schools themselves to outside organizations. So the models exchange, which you will get through the course of this day and get a chance to see it and get into it, lays out and maps different models from EL education to Valor Compass, to the work at Navigator, to new classrooms. And it really shows what's actually happening in the learning. What are teachers doing? What are young people doing? And it's the first step, it's one of the critical steps that I think we have to take for people to even want to fund this thing. They've got to see it. They've got to see that something else is possible. Because school is one of those things, Michael, I'm sure you would agree, where we've all had an experience with it, and generally that experience has been the same. It's one of those things many of us have experienced. And so we all kind of have an idea in our heads about what we think a great education is. And sometimes it's very, spoiler alert, very similar to what we have experienced ourselves. So it can be really hard to imagine what could math look like oriented around a totally different purpose. What could physical education look like oriented around student thriving? What could science and humanities look like if they came together in unison in different ways? And so this model exchange is really trying to get out into the world images of what it looks like, videos of what it looks like, resources and tools for communities to use on their design journeys.
Well, I love it a ton. I think it's a big advance for the field. And it strikes me that not only will it spark communities to say, hey, there's something that stretches my conception of what's possible, I'm now going to ask some questions that might lead me to something pretty neat. Mm-hmm. But frankly, also that it's going to hopefully cause state policymakers and federal policymakers to say, how do I create room for these innovations that in fact exist and allow them to thrive in a way that is in the interests of each and every student that those models are serving? Hopefully, and Joel, I think this is from you, but hopefully giving way to those innovation zones thoughtfully designed. So it's not just the Wild West, but it's really embracing the principles of each individual succeeding on their journey through the education system. Last word from both of you. As we sort of wind up here and kick it off to the great lineup of panels, Janae, why don't you go first, and then Joel, you get the final word.
Sure. I think I would say thank you so much for joining us. This is one of those things where you might be coming in and thinking, I've heard all I need to hear about innovation and education. I'm tired. I'm exhausted. I'm old. I can't do this. And I think what I would say to you is that there are communities across the country that we have seen, particularly during the pandemic, who are excited, who are invigorated, and who know that something new is needed. And so we're really hoping that the out-of-the-box work can be the spark and the opening for a really important conversation that we need to have around around what our schools need to look like for our young people. So I would say thank you for coming and keep an open and bright mind about what's to come.
Joel, last word.
Great. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Janae. I just want to close this out with a story about a trucker. We told the story in the paper. A trucker's name is Malcolm McLean in the early 1950s. And he had this idea. And his idea was, what if the cargo that he had on his truck could be then uploaded onto ships? And that would that make shipping much more economical, much more feasible? Now, the way shipping had operated for 3,000 years since the time of the Phoenicians was different sized boxes getting loaded and unloaded, and some would break and some would get lost. And his basic idea was they could all fit into shipping containers and they could transfer easily from train to truck to ship. That idea fundamentally reshaped how we think about international commerce today. I think we're at a sort of a similar place in K-12. The way we have done school has been the way we have done school for more than a century. It doesn't have to be this way. Our biggest limit actually isn't supply, demand, or policy. I lied. It's really our own imagination. It's our own conceiving of what is truly possible in the 21st century if we were to truly build a new kind of educational system that is really positioned for each individual student to thrive. And our hope is that model providing is one step in that direction.
Joel, Janae, great wisdom, great words. I think in short, we're looking to spark conversation. We're looking to spark curiosity. And then we're looking to spark some creative innovation on behalf of each and every student. That's truly out of the box thinking. So I hope you all enjoy the program that has been lined up for today to really design us to do all that. And with that, I'll say so long from us. Let's enjoy the rest of the day.